The oceanic reefs of northwest Australia are some of the world's most isolated. Sitting on the edge of the continental shelf, hundreds of kilometres from the mainland and from each other. They have survived sea level changes and environmental fluctuations over tens of thousands of years. But with the astonishing rate of change now taking place in our world, even these ancient reefs have an uncertain future. Rising from hundreds of meters depth, the steep edges of the atolls are topped by a wide reef flat. Water rushes through the narrow channels connecting the outer slope to the lagoon, where the sandy lagoon floor is covered in patches of staghorn corals and peppered by outcrops of massive corals and their communities of plants and animals. The isolation of these reefs means reaching them is a challenge. Even from the nearest port, the steam to Scott and Seringapatam takes a full day. Another half a day is required to reach the Ashmore Reefs further north. But the journey is well worth the effort. The reefs are home to a staggering diversity of organisms, residents that live in and among the corals, and those that visit the reefs as part of their migrations over hundreds or even thousands of kilometres. By comparison, there are few human visitors, although some reefs are frequented by Indonesian fishers, making the same journeys by sail as their ancestors hundreds of years ago. Today, their meagre catch of the remaining trochus, sea cucumbers and shark fin are increasingly supplemented by fin fish. Apart from this traditional catch, fishing pressures are low, and the lack of pollution and the distance from the mainland mean water quality at the reefs is excellent. Isolation has spared the reefs from many local pressures. But as with all, they are increasingly affected by global pressures, particularly the heating of the world's oceans. We became acutely aware of this threat in 1998 when high water temperatures caused corals on many reefs around the world to bleach. Those in the Indian Ocean were among the worst affected, and at Scott and Seringapatam, 80% of the corals bleached and died. Over the following months, their skeletons eroded and collapsed, leaving the reef looking like a desolate moonscape. The prospects of a rapid recovery were bleak, given that very few coral larvae travel the vast distances from unaffected reefs. Over several years, there were few signs of recovery. But bare space remained for new corals to recolonize, thanks in part to the many herbivorous fishes and the water quality, which promoted excellent growth and survival of the few new corals that settled on the reef. As these new corals matured, they in turn produced many more offspring, and the rate of recovery increased rapidly. Within 15 years, all but the oldest corals had been replaced. This recovery of Scott Reef was testament to the resilience of all reefs, provided their local conditions were not degraded. It also provided hope. If local conditions are managed, reefs had the best chance of surviving until we can address the problem of rising ocean temperatures. But of course, the climate clock was ticking. Temperature records were being broken at an alarming rate. Another global coral bleaching event was coming. In the summer of 2015 to 2016, strong El Niño conditions again heated the world's oceans to unprecedented levels. As the hot water travelled west through the Pacific and then Indian Oceans, reefs bleached, one after the other. Scott and Seringapatam were bathed in hot water for several weeks. Temperatures in the shallows were over 33 degrees Celsius, well above the threshold for bleaching. Coral bleaching occurred as deep as 40 meters. Corals of all shapes and sizes had bleached, including those least susceptible to high temperatures. The devastation was visible everywhere, underwater and from the air. Many corals that had previously bleached white were dead and covered in algae, while most others died over the following months. This bleaching event was as bad as that in 1998, or worse, and this time, as ocean temperatures continue to rise, the recovery of Scott and Seringapatam is far from certain. Scientists have documented the link between ocean warming and coral bleaching for over two decades. The link is unequivocal. If temperatures continue to rise, the consequences for reefs, the animals that depend on them, and the benefits they provide for all of humanity will be catastrophic. But there is time to act. Scott Reef is testament to the resilience of coral reefs already affected by mass bleaching, and other reefs are yet to be as devastated. Humanity has shown previously a remarkable ability to adapt to such challenges, to develop innovative solutions, but only once a consensus is reached and the responsibility shared by all to address this global problem.